Welcome to This Week in Health IT, where we discuss the news, information, and emerging thought with leaders from across the healthcare industry. This is episode number 18. It's Friday, May 11th. Today, we're going to talk about tackling the growing talent shortage within IT. This podcast is brought to you by Health Lyrics. Change is everywhere in healthcare IT. Get a plan for agile, efficient, and cost-effective IT from people who've been in your shoes. Get ahead of the wave. Visit healthlyrics.com to schedule your free consultation. My name is Bill Russell, recovering healthcare CIO, writer, and consultant with the previously mentioned Health Lyrics. You know, healthcare is loaded with really good people, people who are on your side, who are ready to be in it with you at a moment's notice. And no one epitomizes this more than our guest today. Today, I'm joined by David Muntz, principal at Starbridge Advisors. David, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Appreciate it. The opportunity is really nice.
You know, I think sometimes, you know, you're such a luminary, you've been around for so long that people would think that maybe you're unapproachable, but you are clearly one of the most approachable. If people see you at a conference or whatever, they should just walk up and introduce themselves. You're one of the most approachable people and willing to help, and that's what I've really appreciated about you.
Good. Well, I tell people the strongest ability I have is availability. So yeah. If you've been around long enough, you get to have a lot of great experiences, and I love sharing them. So thank you.
Well, I'm looking forward to this. You know, with the combination of our gray hair, we should have something to say. For people who aren't familiar with you, let me give you a little bit of the bio here. So you began your career as a biostatistician. Well, what exactly is a biostatistician?
It's somebody who takes statistics, and in my case, worked in a cancer and leukemia research hospital, and so I made the data speak and tell the story to the physicians who were taking care of the patients there.
Wow, and so that somehow led you on a path to become a CIO, so then you became eventually became CIO at Texas Health Resources for 15 years, and then 5 years at Baylor Healthcare System, I guess before the Baylor Scott and White merger. Yes.
Actually, I was part of that activity, so it was a really interesting, you know, it's always interesting to go through the merger and acquisition discussion.
Yeah, so this latest round of M&A is not, you know, this has happened before, and there's a lot of experience out there around it. So so it gets really interesting here. So in 2012, you accepted a White House appointment to serve as the first principal deputy national coordinator. Chief of Staff and CIO at the ONC. So for all of us who are wondering, what's it like to work in the federal government around healthcare?
Well, actually, financially, it's terrible. every other aspect, it's just fabulous. The fact is that it's really like getting a crash course in an area where you really have no exposure or experience before. And I've done a little work in the state, but nothing to compare with the federal activities. And working inside Health and Human Services was really an honor because of the diversity of the activities associated with healthcare. And we talk about the healthcare continuum, and there is nobody who has a broader view of the continuum than HHS. And because I was a political appointee, I got to sit in the meetings where we discussed policy, and it was fabulous to actually watch the formulation of policy, even though they say there are two things you should never watch is sausage making and policy making.
Yeah. And I think some people, because of their maybe cynical view of the government or legislature or whatnot, might think that, you know, these aren't the smartest people in healthcare, but they are some of the things that people are doing at the government level in terms of biodefense and cybersecurity and policy. These are some of the smartest people in healthcare, and they just don't operate in the limelight, so we just don't see them all that often.
It's very true, and the fact is that these people feel a passion for what they do. They're public servants in the kindest way that you can take that word. Servanthood is how they live, and you know, I had a secretary who was a lawyer, an assistant who was worked for me, who was also had a MBA and was a CPA. And so people doing just normal jobs have these extraordinary credentials, but every one of them shared a big heart and dedication. And it's the permanent staff there that makes the government work well. So Now, when people say it's good enough for government work, I always correct them, saying that government work was some of the most effective I'd seen. Now, whether or not you agree with what the decisions are is another issue. But the one thing I would like to say to people is, and the reason I went to the government, is if you don't like what's happening, you need to express yourself or you need to join and help try to make the changes from inside.
Yep.
And so there aren't enough people there who have experience in health IT. And I think that was the advantage I brought to the position.
Yeah, I hear that a lot. People go, well, I don't want those people making decisions. And you know what? There's, you know, MU is a great example. You know, that stuff's out there for comment right now. So comment.
Yeah. Well, that's how I got there. I used to raise my fist and go, what are you thinking? And they got and I was on the board at Chime in charge of policy at the time, assisted by the way, a lot of very brilliant CIOs. But I was always the one that would do the final editing. And so I communicated frequently my displeasure with the programs, and what I wanted to bring to the government was a practical and pragmatic approach.
Right. And when you raise your fist, they assume that you're raising your hand. So when they say, hey, we need an appointee, it's like, hey, that guy has his hand up.
Yeah, by the way, when I got there, I continued raising my fist in the meeting.
So CIO of Get Well Network, member of the board of directors there still, and also board of AHIMA. Tell us about that work a little bit. So you were there for 3 years, or you're currently there for 3 years?
No, I finished just the last, or in the middle of the year.
Yeah, because, you know, Chime, they get up there and they talk about AHIMA, AHIA, and I forget the other one. And a lot of us are sitting back going, that's way too many acronyms. So tell us a little bit about that.
Well, yeah, if you don't like acronyms, watch the government. The fact is that AHIMA really is one of the largest organizations for healthcare, and we think of them as the old medical records group, and they are far more capable than that. It's some of the most dedicated people I've ever worked with, and they are frequently unsung heroes when it comes to moving data around. So there's nobody who really has a more end-to-end view of what goes on in healthcare than the people who work in health information management. So it was a pleasure to be on the board there, and what I kept pushing them to do was to be ill-behaved. And to try to get a chair at the table with the CIO. And I would love to see a greater partnership between the people in HIM.
Yeah, but knowing you, it's be ill-behaved, so get noticed, but do it in a respectful way.
I mean, absolutely. There are ways that you can say things with candor and kindness at the same time.
Right. So you've led... you know, tons of great teams. You know, it says here in your bio that, you know, at any given time, and people don't recognize this, as a CIO, you oversee a lot of projects, and you note here, you know, more than 180 project go lives annually. And most people outside of our industry would say, that's crazy. I can't believe there's that many. But those of us who have sat in the chair go, yeah, that's about the right number for the size organizations you were doing.
Oh, yeah. We can, just to give you some context, we used to say that a project was anything that involved more than 40 hours. So that'll give you a sense of it. So it could be something as large as a EHR implementation or as small as a implementation of a departmental system.
Yeah. So you were two different organizations, Chime's Innovator of the Year, and in 2014, Chime presented you with your CIO Legacy Award. So, I mean, that's a great bio, and probably the most time I've spent on anyone's bio, just so you know. I mean, there's so much. I mean, it's like multiple careers here. I mean, it's very fascinating. You know, one of the things we like to do with our co-hosts is give them an opportunity to talk about what they're currently working on or what they're excited about. So, you know, this is your couple minutes to sort of share what's going on.
Sure. Well, after serving as a CIO for a very long time, I decided it was time to come back to Texas to spend time with family and wanted to have a little more freedom. And so consulting is how I started. And after starting my own company, I decided, at the invitation of Sue Shade and Russ Rudish, to join them and start Starbridge Advisors. And you know only too well, and I'm sure every CIO in the country knows only too well that there is far more demand than supply. And so the focus of our company is really to give additional bandwidth to CIOs. And one of the things that's fascinating, again, is what it takes to start up your own company, as you know only too well. And so I've been engaged in activities that are designed to provide interim support, to provide consulting services, and also to do some coaching and mentoring. And the idea is not that the CIO isn't capable of doing that, or either CMIO, CNIO, CMO, or CTO, but they don't have the time to pay attention to all the things they wanted to. And as you noted from my resume, when we're doing that many projects, you can't pay attention to more than a handful. And so, by the way, I was blessed in every organization by having wonderful employees around me and take care of me. So that's the key to my success. And by the way, a very patient family. But I enjoy offering assistance to those people who just don't have the time to do the work themselves.
Yeah, and I was in two rooms this week with different groups of CIOs. And it's interesting, and we've highlighted it on the show. Some people come from a clinical background. Some people come from a technology background. Some people come from neither, just come from a business background and just know how to get the most out of people. And the good CIOs recognize when there's areas where they're, you know, they could use some help, be it on the technical, clinical, or the business side. And I know that people have brought you in on the business side a lot to say, you know, how do we handle this transaction? How do we handle this interaction with the federal government? Given your background, I mean, you have some great insights into those things, and that's where they pick up the phone and call Starbridge and get you guys engaged. All right. So as you know, so the format of the show is we talk about the news, then we do a little bit of soundbite section where we put you on the hot seat, and then we do a social media close, which is just a little bit of fun to close out the show. So I'll kick us off with the first story. And, you know, the biggest story from last week may not have been in healthcare, but it really does impact healthcare. And that is the U.S. unemployment rate is now the lowest it's been in this century, right? And it becomes a challenge for healthcare to find great talent. And, you know, how bad is labor shortage? Wall Street Journal had an article 2 weeks ago that talks about cities will now pay people to move there. Cities will pay people to move there. And I've had conversations with CIOs where they said, you know, and we talk about all this really cool stuff and what you could do with Lambda architecture and that kind of stuff. And they say, there are no people in my city that understand the technology that you are talking about. We are going the Microsoft route. And that is a very valid and actually pretty wise, you know, way to look at it, is to say, what can I do with the talent I have? Not what is the really cool and exciting thing that's, you know, right around the corner. So, you know, these two stories provide us with a snapshot of what's happening now and probably what's going to happen over the next 2 to 3 years. That, you know, whenever you have this kind of tax cut, we saw a major boom after Reagan did that massive tax cut. And we'll probably see, just, I'm an economics major, just based on pure economics, we've just poured a ton of money into the economy, and it's like a log on the fire. So for the foreseeable future, there's going to be this talent shortage. And so let's go back and forth on a couple things of how CIOs might think about this, or just how people might. Let's start with kids going to college. I remember when I was going to college in 1980 something. They were saying, hey, get your computer science degree. And everybody did. And then when we came out, everybody had a computer science degree. And so there was, you know, an abundance. But what's that major you're telling college kids as they're going in there? They say, I want to be in healthcare IT. I want to be in IT technology some way. And I want to be in healthcare. What are those degrees that they should be pursuing right now?
Well, it really is a tough question to answer, and everybody's situation is different. But generally speaking, I say that there's one thing that they have to concentrate on, that's a skill that you need no matter where you're going to be in whatever profession, and that is the ability to communicate verbally, and that's either orally or in writing. And that's really number one on your list. So if you don't come out with good communication skills, You won't be able to sell yourself. You won't be able to explain things, and you're just not going to be able to succeed. But the fact is that there are many different pathways into healthcare. And so I happen to be a pre-med major in college and in English with a minor. And of course, nobody can see the straight pathway, but I love that country western song that says, God bless the crooked path that led me straight to you. And so the real key is, if you know that you love healthcare, the idea is to pursue something that complements the activities that are going on in your area of interest. Now, I happen to be married to a nurse, the father of a nurse, and we married a nurse, and I have a niece, so I'm very nurse friendly. So if I had to say something, it's, you know, follow a clinical pathway. There is never going to be a lack of need for healthcare professionals. And if you don't mind me switching to a tactic that I used to use to fill positions when I was strapped for people who had clinical experience, I used to call the presidents of the organization together, both at THR and Baylor Healthcare System, and say, we've got this big, we're going to kick off, and I don't have enough people with clinical skills. I've got plenty of people with technical skills. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to find who are the best people in each one of the areas where we're implementing the software. And I'm going to pull them onto the project team. And if you don't say, ouch, I haven't found the right person yet. And so we would populate our projects with the best of the people in the clinical areas. And generally speaking, once they got into healthcare IT, it wasn't touching one person at a time. It was touching hundreds or thousands at a time. And it was easy to draw them over. So I would say you don't need as much technical skill as you need human skills.
Wow. And, you know, and John Wooden is quoted as saying, the team with the best players usually wins. And so if you can gather those great leaders, that is always extremely helpful. You know, the clinical side, we are seeing more and more on the clinical side, people getting that clinical background and then making a move either towards analytics or towards data science or, you know, it just all areas within IT, because it's fascinating to them how much, so they got into healthcare because they want to help people.
You bet.
They're generally very caring people, high empathy, and we need more of that in IT. Oh, have always needed more of that in IT.
Absolutely.
But their understanding of clinical also helps them to be empathetic towards the other clinicians, as, you know, we've rolled out some bad technology that has been designed by technologists over the years. And so we get a bad rap from time to time from the clinicians of, do you know how many clicks it takes to get this data? Why can't we visualize the data in this way? And, you know, having those clinicians there to ground us in terms of the process, as well as very attuned to the patients, very attuned to the consumers of healthcare and what they're asking for as well. So that's a great, you know, I'm typical technologist. I'm going to say analytics. If I'm talking to a college student, analytics will not steer you wrong. Data science is not going to steer you wrong anytime in the next decade, I don't believe. AI programming is one of those things that I believe we're going to need more of. We're going to be teaching the machines how to think, how to process information. You know, we now have digital vision, you know, obviously machines are hearing us now, and we're going to need people that can sort of build those new constructs for us. And then security. I mean, we'll get into security in your article that you shared. You know, we're at war right now. I mean, there's a cyber war going on, and you know, need people to sign up for that. So, you know, you gave us one of the strategies. You know, give us some of the other strategies that CIOs can employ to find the best talent.
Really, it's the best approach that I've used that worked well was the summer intern activity. We used to beg, borrow, and steal to get into the budget enough money to do things. But you can take students from anywhere and everywhere. And to let you know, the only time that we brought on a student who didn't stay with us was one who wanted to move back to be close to her parents. But we used to get 5 to 8 people every summer and grow our own. And the fact is, the enthusiasm is really a great quality to find in any employee. And these people would start at the lowest level to get a good understanding. We put them at the help desk, and that would give them an exposure and a good test of patience, but it would also allow them to see the diversity of needs. Put them on the floors and have them do the
So what are the steps to set up a good internship program? Because when I went to St. Joe's, I was kind of surprised we didn't have one within IT. Mm-hmm. We were bringing high school students for 1 week over the summer. And that was fascinating. That was great for my team. My team loved that week of working with those high school kids. But how do you put together a good program that's going to appeal to undergraduates as well as graduate students to bring them in and expose them to healthcare?
Well, truthfully, I have to tell you that my administrative assistant was the one who made this a success.
We'll have to have your administrative assistant on.
Oh, she's fabulous. One employee of the year in the healthcare industry, in Dallas. I'm really telling you that she deserved the credit. But there are enthusiasm of those kids to get experiences is huge. And so the pool is very large, larger than you can possibly imagine. So I would call together my direct reports and their direct reports, and we would scour through the resumes. And, we made guesses at what would be good fits based on what they had as experience and what they put down as mission and goal in life. And we really didn't focus as much on the technology things as we did, on the soft skills. Because if you hire the right person, they can pick up the technical skills. And being very deliberate about the time, making sure that you have somebody administratively taking care of the program is a real key to that.
Yeah, one of the things I loved that our data team did was they started tapping into the various graduates and even PhD programs, and we set up a way for them to access anonymized data within our system that they were doing really neat things. And part of that was almost a retraining of our data team internally, because they were coming face to face with the most, and we were not an academic medical center, so we didn't have the access that at least an academic medical center would have to that level of academic rigor and whatnot. And so by partnering on that level, man, we were seeing all sorts of new ways of visualizing data, of really breaking it apart. So don't just look at the college interns, the kids with no money. Also, try to figure out ways to tap into those PhD programs, because you know what? They want access to healthcare. They want access to the data. It so benefits them to partner with a health system that has at least their act together in terms of providing access to that level of depth within a healthcare organization.
Yeah, and just one more little trick or tip. We also would look at projects that were 3 to 5 months in length, and we would go to graduate schools, just like you suggested, which I think is great. And we would say, we have a fixed program that we want you to complete. Can you make this one of their senior projects? And because of the remote nature now of work, it was easy to get that done. And they actually had a real world deliverable that we would actually put into production at the end of the process. Now, we only did that a few times, but we were successful in each case.
Well, great. I've been going long on this show the last couple of weeks. Yes. So I'm gonna kick to you for the next story, and we'll probably only spend maybe 5 minutes on the next story.
Okay, I'll try to speak a little faster. The draw slows me down. One of the things that happened this week that I thought was very interesting was that Rob Joyce left the White House as the cybersecurity chief. And John Bolton is pushing to eliminate that post. And that caused me a little heartburn. And so I'm curious about what your reaction is to the White House taking its eye, if you will, off or changing its focus.
Great. So you're going to ask me a political question on
exactly.
This, so I can't hide. I'm going to quickly steer this back towards cybersecurity in healthcare. But is it the right move? I don't know, but Here's my gut. Cybersecurity should be handled by the military and Homeland Security. The reason I believe that is because it literally is a war. If you go in and look at your log files of who's, it used to be that we would say, you know, it's still true that a majority of cybersecurity incidents happen internally. So it's your people that are exfiltrating data for whatever reason. And then, and in nation states was this little subsection of people that were trying to get into your data. That has not completely flip-flopped, but that nation state attack has grown exponentially over the last, I would say, 2 to 3 years. And, you know, most of the malware and stuff that we're looking at today was developed by governments, if not our government, and, you know, has fallen into the wrong hands. So I think it's a military and a homeland security thing. So, you know, only in the federal government do we create a job and think it can never go away. I don't think we lose any focus. Every branch of the military now has a cyber command and a cybersecurity group. Yes. Homeland Security does. The FBI investigates. So it's not for lack of a cybersecurity focus. The question is, how does that information and stuff get to the president? And, you know, there's a Secretary of Defense. There's a Secretary of Homeland Security. It could filter up through that. So if we were going to reorg it like a business, we would look at it and go, that's a redundant position. That's my gut. I don't want emails on, you know, politics or whatever. So let's flip this to health IT. So we're, you know, we're talking about how to reorg the government. How do you reorg IT? So what's the best way for IT? Because that's really the question. What roles need to be in place in healthcare IT in order to have a very good focus on cybersecurity and be able to inform and educate the board and the various things that need to happen? Mm-hmm. I mean, what's the best, I'm turning this right back on you, what's the best organization and way to get ready for that?
Yeah, this is an interesting time. And people say that they want the cybersecurity people reporting up to compliance or to the board itself. And to take it away from the CIO. And I'm not so sure that I agree with that. And the reason is that the people who are wonderful at cybersecurity have to be a little bit paranoid. And that paranoid is not based on false concerns, it's based on a reality. But there always is this balance that you need to make. And so the question is, who's the best risk manager in your organization? And if the CIO can play that role, then cybersecurity should probably report to them. The reason I suggest the CIO is because really they speak some form of cybersecurity probably more effectively than many of the other groups that have been typically assigned as we're making reassignments of cybersecurity. So I still think the CISO should have a reporting relationship to the CIO. And I think if that's not the case, there should always be a CIO and CISO in discussions where you're trying to make decisions about how to take care of the cybersecurity or actually all of the IT assets that you have responsibility for. And it's the trade between access and security that always is the most difficult thing to assess.
Yeah. And yeah, I'll give a little different spin on that in that sure. When I came into St. Joe's, all the security reported up through me. And one of the first things we did is we hired a chief security officer, not a chief information security officer, chief security officer who had had a digital background, and that reported into compliance. So oversaw physical security, I mean, you name it, building security, as well as really compliance around information security. Which was interesting. So I now had a peer who, you know, the two of us would always go together to the board and present because he would present, hey, here's where we're at. And I would talk about the very specific minutia of, okay, you know, here's the investments that it's going to take. Here's what we're trying to defend against and those kinds of things. I would be very focused on cybersecurity. And so we sort of tag team there. The thing I liked about it was, he was very focused on education. And quite frankly, the biggest risk we have is 23,000 employees clicking on an email, giving away their credentials, reusing passwords externally and that kind of stuff. And so, you know, that that element of the training and education he was focused on every day. So I think, you know, cybersecurity, most CISOs I've met are really strong technically, but when you talk about influencing an organization, they almost need to be at the C level in terms of how do you drive education programs and how to, and those kind of things. So we had a little, I don't know if it's different, but we had a little different bent on it. You know, we stole a guy from MD Anderson, and he became our chief security officer, and he was phenomenal, and a great partner for me, and a pain in the ass. But anyway, that was his role. His role was to get in my face and say, we're not making enough progress in these areas. How are we going to move the needle? He never said, this is how I want you to move the needle. He would say, how are we going to move the needle in these, you know, he had 10 different areas that he was measuring across for us. So.
No, I think, by the way, I think I love that idea. I think, you know, security at that level makes perfect sense. So good model.
Yeah, it was, there's a lot of different ways to do it. And, you know, I'm sure people have different models. So, all right, we're going to jump to the soundbite section, and I have five questions for you, and I'm just going to ask the question. You get about 2 minutes to answer, and we'll just move on. I'll try not to comment on your answer. So, given your government background, assuming there's no changes, that it goes through the comment period and no changes, what do you think the impact of the new MU program promoting interoperability is going to be on healthcare?
Not enough. And the reason is that we keep pushing interoperability that's based on patient matching. And I think except for actually positive person identification, all the pieces that we need are already in place in the private sector. So I had pushed for a private sector approach to this. But I think having the ONC push for interoperability is really important. I would like to see them look for combination of biometrics and a user-selected identifier like we use with every other product that we have, for example, email, Facebook, whatever, to be able to help identify those naked and unconscious people who show up in our EDs, not to mention the people who come through the front door but have very common shared names.
Great. I'm going to hold myself to not commenting on that. So, because there's a lot of ways we can approach interoperability. So that's fascinating. Okay. So you're a part of a group that's looking to hire a new CIO. So you guys do interim CIO placements.
Yes.
With Starbridge. So you're looking to hire a new CIO. I'm now putting you on a board for a health system. What are the three most important attributes you're looking for in your next CIO?
Well, we happen to be comprised of people who have a lot of experience. And so I'm always interested in people who have experience and depth. So that's one. But diplomacy is probably the other. And under diplomacy, I'm cheating, because under diplomacy, I'd make a list of characteristics, including communications, empathy, et cetera, that I would think are associated with diplomacy. And the other really is optimism, which underneath it would have energy as well. So those are probably the three things that are most important to me. And ultimately, by the way, as you know too well, every relationship is based on good chemistry. So what you have to be able to do is look at that combination of characteristics, make sure that the profile of the organization is consistent with the profile of the individual who you might be putting forth as a candidate.
Yep. And I had an article I wrote on Health System CIO about hiring the best CTO candidate. I had the five C's. In order to drive hits to that article, you'll have to go to Health System CIO and see what the five C's were that I gave. So
I will do that.
So you have a unique perspective here. I'm going to a little twist on a question I asked you earlier. So you've worked with the health systems, private sector. You've worked in the public sector at ONC. You're talking to a college student who wants to have an impact on healthcare. Which direction do you point them in? Do you point them into the private sector, or do you point them into the public sector, or what attributes of the person would point you, help you to guide them in either direction?
Yeah, it depends on whether you want to work on a micro or a macro level, really. And ultimately, if you're interested in the macro, I think the government is a great place to work. I would suggest that you have experience before you come to the government. So I'd push you toward the micro. The fact is that policy made without experience and pragmatism is not necessarily going to work. It would be surprising if it does. And so, you know, that pragmatism and practicality is critical. So head toward the private sector first. Then when you've gotten to the point where you can make a contribution, policy is a great place to join. And by the way, you can make policy on the local level, the regional level, the state level, and the national level, which is actually exactly what I did in my career.
Right. And so working in either doesn't break you for the other. If you've spent too much time in the private sector, you can still go into the public. If you spend a bunch of time in the public, you can still go into the private.
Yes. And the important thing is to maintain that optimism, regardless of which direction you choose.
Yeah. You seem to have the right temperament for both. So what is something that the ONC does for healthcare that may surprise healthcare leaders?
Yeah, you know, the thing that people don't really associate with the ONC is their laser-like focus on making sure the data is available to patients and providers. And what they see is, oh, they're just in here to regulate features, functions, and to provide some money. And that is not why ONC exists. ONC wants to make data accessible, and the products that are out there don't always make that so easy. Hence the reason of ability. So that's part of the reason that you've seen that. And you need somebody who's still passionate about interoperability to lead that effort.
Yeah, no, that's great. So 180 project go lives. I'd be remiss if I didn't ask you this question. You've had some level of success, because if your first 10 fail, they don't let you do 180. Give us a handful of things that that health IT can learn from your success. So we want to replicate your success over 180 project go lives. You know, what would you tell us?
Sure. I would say, you know, it really gets down to demand management. No matter what else you're doing, you have to have a very strong governance process.
So you're controlling the funnel.
Exactly. And one of the things you have to, part of the reason for governance is not just to control the funnel, but to get the people engaged. And so I never led a governance committee. I always would set it up, do all the work that had to be done, take care of all the administration. But the people who populated those committees were all from the operations side. And we would always have a president who had some sway at one of the hospitals chair the committee. And interestingly enough, IT had no vote on any of the prioritization or project approvals. And the idea was the operations is earning the money, the operations is doing the clinical work, operations should make the decision about what the priorities should be and the order in which things should be done. Our job was to talk about what made sense, and there are some dependencies there, but having brilliant people working for you, as I have enjoyed my entire career, is the key. But I can't tell you how powerful it is to ask people what they want and then let them make the decisions. The challenge we all have as IT people is that when I did surveys of people who had the same kind of discipline that we did and were tracking numbers, the lowest demand to supply ratio was 5-1. And people were sometimes at 16-1. So the idea is you cannot, you know, there's an old, and I attribute this to coach. No coach ever said this, but it sounds like something a coach would say. And I used to tell my staff all the time, you need to focus on this. We can do anything. We can't do everything. Yeah. And you have to be able to say no. And you don't create a backlog in that process. You say, this is what I'm going to do this year, and I'm going to ask you again in another year what you want to do for the next 18 months after that. So that you don't have this heavy weight on the staff of IT or the organization, and because things change, as you know, every day in healthcare, and priorities will shift from year to year.
Yeah, no, that's great wisdom and advice in that area.
Can I do one bit of advertising?
Sure.
Yeah, the Gartner article that was published about what we did at Baylor, if you want to see in a lot more detail what it is that I was talking about.
Is there a title for that article?
Baylor Healthcare System offers strong example of a PMO's ability to help healthcare systems manage high IT demand.
Wow.
is the answer.
Great. Well, we'll definitely have to pull that article up and reference it in the post. So we're at the close of the show. We close with our favorite social media post of the week. I'll go first. So this past week, I got to attend the inaugural health conference at the Aria in Vegas. It was interesting. There was about 4,000 people there. It was highly tech centric in terms of just the, you know, it's all around innovation and those kind of things. Pretty well attended, very well run conference. So I don't know. I don't know if I'm recommending it, but I'm saying it was fascinating, good speakers. David Feinberg, CEO of Geisinger, did the keynote, and he had this quote, and he's a quote machine. I love people like this. So at Geisinger Health, we have 13 hospitals. I think my job is to close all of them. I know that if we use proven and behavioral techniques to get us healthy again, half of the 2,000 beds I'm responsible for would not be there. Just an interesting approach. This is the same guy who said, we want to get rid of the waiting room and all that it represents. You know, think about those quotes. I don't think that's an announcement that we're going to get rid of every hospital in Geisinger, but it's saying we can do better at keeping people out of the hospital, and that should be our focus. So it's very interesting. Sure. So do you have one?
No, the one I would suggest that you look for is something that Jonathan Perlin, who is the CMO at HCA, talked about. It was the virtuous cycle and how that was related to analytics and what they had done to work on bloodstream infection. So just fascinating. And he's one of the most brilliant, eloquent speakers I know. So that's well worth looking.
Well, thank you. Thanks for confirming that you are a nerd. We appreciate this stuff.
I've got my pocket protector to prove.
Biostatistician to CIO. What's the commonality? Yeah, you love getting down into the minutia of how things work. So, thank you again for coming on the show. So, give us an idea of how people can people follow you on social media at all?
Sure. I do have at David Muntz. Twitter handle, and then as part of Starbridge Advisors, there's an at Starbridge Health IT or HIT that we use, and I try to push people to starbridgeadvisors.com, where we highlighted this week that Sue Shade was one of the top 50 women in healthcare IT. Not an uncommon place for her to be, and very proud of what she's accomplished.
Absolutely. Formerly on the show, and I'm sure will be again. I'm looking forward to having her back on the show. So awesome. You can follow me on Twitter, @thepatientcio. My writing on health on the Health Lyrics website, I noted Health System CIO picks up an article every other week. Don't forget to follow the show at This Week in HIT and check out the website, thisweekinhealthit.com. If you like the show, please take a couple seconds, leave a review on iTunes or Google Play. And we are now up over 100 videos on thisweekinhealthit.com/video. And that will take you to our YouTube channel. Every show we cut into 1, 2, 3 minute segments, about 5 or 6 a week. And we put those out on social media and we put them up on the show. So we're going to start organizing those by topics, the role of the CIO, AI, data analytics, those kind of things, so people can get more out of the channel itself. So last thing I want to say is if you know of someone you'd like to have us have on the show, please, you know, let us know. Just hit us on one of the social media platforms and you know, just direct message me, and you know, I'm always open to that, and I'm always curious as to who people recommend. It's fascinating to me. And please come back every Friday for more news, information, and commentary from industry influencers. That's all for now.
And can I have one last word?
Sure.
Make sure that all of us who appreciate your thought leadership get a chance to say thank you for what you've done for the industry.
Thanks. I appreciate that. And I will give you the last word. That's all for now.